Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the Hampton Municipal Budget Committee. And tonight is Tuesday, October 20th. Everyone would rise to pledge allegiance to the flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Would I ask you all to remain standing? We lost a friend and a colleague recently in Glenn Farrell. He was a fresh face to this board and was really looking forward to diving into the budget this year. Unfortunately, he won't get that chance, but I'm sure he'll be with us. And he was sitting where I sat for 3 years, and I'll always look for his guidance. We'll miss you, Glenn, and thank you for serving the town of Hampton. If we could have a moment of silence. Thank you.
Go around the table and take this opportunity to introduce ourselves. I'll start on the side tonight with Selectman Bean.
Yes, good evening. Phil Bean. Thank you.
George and I here.
Mike Clough.
Jones.
Stephen LaBranche.
Eileen Latimer.
Brian Lapham.
Sonny Kravitz.
Jim O'Loughlin.
Maureen Buckley.
Mike Pierce.
Scott Blair.
Dick Fry.
Thank you, everyone. Again, before we get into the meeting, remember that for us it's something new that we are, our minutes are being done from outside of this room. So it's very important that when we take a vote that we're very clear and we give our names and we take our time. So if I have to stop us, it's just for the benefit of our secretary at this point in time. And remember, too, that this is a big area. We don't all always get on the camera, on the screen, for her to see us. That's why I've had to move in a little bit. Close up. All right. Correspondence. Had a lot back and forth. There had been a request for numerous questions to go off to DRA. They did. They went up to Steve Hamilton. I had a conversation with him today. The list of the odd things you guys had hanging out, and I have a copy here if you want to view it. I'll also send it to you in an email. Did go to DRA to Stephen. He was very nice. He said he would give us any guidance he can in any of the questions that we sent him. All right. And they were covered in last couple of meetings of things that you wanted me to send up to DRA. Nothing personal on my part. He also informed us, and happily, that he was working on town tax rate today, which was very quick considering it was just passed by the selectmen last night to forward it up to DRA. He had it in his hands and said he would be done by the end of today. And Mr. LaBranche informs us that, in fact, you got an email that it is done. Mm-hmm. So much faster, about a month ahead of schedule from last year. So we're all very happy to hear that. Okay. As far as the correspondence to the Attorney General's office, they have been bogged down in a couple of court issues, Supreme Court issues, but they have told me that they will be getting back to us. But I do not have an answer from our previous correspondence from the last meeting now, so I'm letting you know that.
Is that on the number of people on the Budget Committee?
That's on the number of people on the Budget Committee and the way it was worded and that. And I might cut in there and ask if we have any other correspondence on that.
Yes, I had correspondence with the town clerk on the matter, which I shared with you and one or two other people on the committee, giving my understanding of the situation, which is fairly consistent with yours as I've read yours, just formatted differently, basically.
Mm-hmm.
She informed me that she'd be, and I should expect a decision sometime this week from her.
Okay. The largest problem seems to be nobody wants to be the definitive answer on how we meet the attrition. And if the way the article follows everything, which is why we went to the Attorney General, because that's basically top cop of election law. They actually have a division devoted to election law, and that's where I sent it. And I think it's something that hasn't come up that often. So no, it's like the hot potato that nobody wants to put their final stamp on. But before we get to the election, someone really needs to put their stamp on it. So I have the feeling the way things are working out that we'll hear from it very soon, definitively from a source, and that will be our answer. But we've approached everybody at this point, from municipal to Secretary of State to Attorney General. It's been around through everyone at this point. Michael?
You want to listen to the gossip?
No.
There was a meeting last night in relation to this activity that you spoke of, and I think it's been decided, and I can't give you any of the details, to tune to.
Well, if this is gossip, and I know there was a non-public meeting, so then I would turn to Selectman Bean. Do you have anything to offer at this meeting, or will it come to us at a later time?
And that is on the election going forward, and for the numbers. I believe that the town clerk is going to make her decision. She's empowered to do so. And as soon as she does, I think that's imminent.
So I'll be receiving that soon?
Yes, ma'am.
By the next meeting, hopefully?
I think sooner than that, ma'am.
Okay. Well, that would be good. All right. Thank you. We have progress. Moving on from that subject. All right. Anyone else have anything to add on the correspondence? Okay. Or from me? Am I leaving anything out?
Was the multi-year contracts on your list with that
Yes.
ERA? Okay. It's only one I was hot.
Yeah, I'd be happy to share that list with you.
I believe he's already been privied to the document.
Oh, okay.
I just wasn't aware it was the same document.
All right. As far as the calendar goes, we have no changes in the calendar.
Yeah, the correspondence, though, Irene, have we heard anything that may have come up? I know Fred mentioned last night he was... Has settled on dates for the tour for the...
Yes, that did come up last night.
And maybe Mr. Bean can shed some light on that, what those dates are, in terms of Mike and I's visit as well.
Okay. Selectman Bean, can you help us out in that category?
And again, I'm restacking the new budget. There was, I guess, and the question again was?
Fred indicated last night that he had the dates chosen for a tour of the DPW department to take place. And were two requests, one for the tour and one for Mike and I to go and get into detail with Chris and or Mike Doobie in anticipation of the budget review that's going to happen in here. So we have our facts and sentiment that we could express here. And I asked the chairman, the chairwoman, if in fact we have heard anything on those dates yet.
I think, ma'am, you'll be receiving that email from the town manager very soon, if
okay.
not.
Okay, and to clear that up. There was a lot of confusing email last week. I sent it all out to you. I'm not going to rehash it. Everybody got a copy and a correspondence back and forth regarding, it started out with Mary Louise Woolsey offering to do an external tour of DPW, especially for the new members who don't spend a lot of time at the dump. Some of us have been around for a while. We've been to the dump quite a few times, but it was meant as an educational tour externally. And it ended up with Town Manager Welsh suggesting that he would get the Board of Selectmen to approve two separate dates, one for a complete tour for the committee, and the other for more of a working session with the subcommittee and questions that they have. So it's two separate meetings, one for those members of the committee who would like an internal as well as external tour of DPW, and the second meeting only for the subcommittee as a working session. Now I did hear them, I did hear you approve it last night, but the dates weren't there. So I think there may be what may roll out is a couple of dates that we may have choices from, and I'll wait for that correspondence, and hopefully if you can convey back to the town manager, if we can receive that by the end of this week, since it was approved last night.
I'll send that email tomorrow morning, ma'am.
So that we can see what dates are available and try to work that in our schedule. Brian?
While you're on the subject, I would like to thank Mary Louise, Mike Plough, Sonny Kravitz. We did take a walk through, mm-hmm. and it was very informative. The first date to keep in mind is the 24th. That was spoken last night as the tour. Yes.
They did, but there was a choice.
You said that's going to be the first
right,
one.
And they were going to send everything to you.
Right, it's going to be a choice of dates, so we'll work
but,
into account.
Just keep that in mind.
Okay.
That was one of the dates that was mentioned.
All right.
8 a.m. to 3 p.m.
Oh, God.
Sometime.
Yeah, it was something like that.
The time range they offered on the 24th, which was their preferred date. The 24th is this Saturday, of course.
Mm.
Okay. Well, they'll have a choice of dates, and we'll work from there. It's progress, and thank you, those members who did go. One more piece of communication for the IT subcommittee. We had a question about for the library about how they would like to address the protocol,
mm-hmm.
and they would like it to be the same as it is with the town manager's protocol.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. All right, moving on. Like I said, no changes to the calendar. And requests for information at this point. Last night, how many of you watched last night's?
Yeah, I did.
Quite a few. I have to say that.
You're always there, Brian.
If ever there was a meeting worth going back and watching, mm-hmm. last night was it. There was a lot of information in last night's meeting for you. There was a good presentation by our police chief on equipment that he needs. There was information about tax rate and decision to take $500,000 out of the reserves
FB.
And put that towards the tax rate, like they did last year. They took $1 million last year. Last night, they voted to take $500,000. So that will decrease the impact of the increase in the tax rate. Plenty of information to that regard. One more thing that we brought up and like to think we nursed a little bit before we sent it off to selectmen was discussion about the snow insurance or bad mm. weather insurance or however that ended up being termed. I heard a quote last night of $14,000.
Yes, ma'am, or in the ballpark. Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
That doesn't sound right.
No, believe it or not, when I looked into it, it was actually not a back breakup. And that's why I suggested it. You would think that it would be a lot more.
Yeah, we would have benefited by $300,000, I think they said.
Yeah, almost $400,000 for $14,000 is like.
Yeah, it didn't. Something's not right.
There was some discussion last night that we can't afford it, but I'm really hoping that even if you have to go to the reserves, that perhaps the Board of Selectmen can find it for this coming year because the snow removal sometimes breaks our backs and $14,000 doesn't seem like very much.
I believe that was their intention.
That is almost too good to believe.
Yeah, I agree, Jerry.
Get $14,000 in premium and, you know, to have a storm completely covered, a whole budget completely covered. This doesn't fit like a puzzle. It should fit. I mean, to meet a premium.
I know.
Insurance is a bet. I mean, I guess.
Sure it is.
And we have the money to cover our bet in the reserves. We're paying somebody else for that risk factor, and I just can't see that working. We should be self-insured, which we are, for something like that. Right?
Well, we were this year, and we paid $400,000.
Yeah.
But so that's the given.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
There is.
One point with insurance proposals is they promise you in the big print for August 1, but when the fine print, they take it all back. So $14,000 may sound cheap, but it may not work out to help.
Sonny makes a good point, and I'm going to elaborate on that in a moment. But I do want to point out that I don't believe there's any provision for taking money out of the undesignated fund balance to pay for a non-existent appropriation. Furthermore, the town manager stated last night, in order for it to be covered for the winter, the payment would have been made, would have had to have been made by May. And of course, this is after May.
I think he said November.
No, he said November.
Did he? Yeah, it was November. That's why I was bringing it up, and maybe put a little fire under it.
Yep, it has to be paid by
November. As feasibility. And as far as the fine.
I have more to say, please.
I'm sorry?
I have more to say. The statement that Sonny was made was absolutely correct. The big print says one thing, the fine print says another. We don't know what's covered there. The way it was described last night, $14,000 sounds very attractive. Too attractive. And the way it was described, that if we had it last year, we would have cut $300,000 off of one storm. Which suggests to me that the coverage might be that if a single storm is over an average storm, that it's covered. It's not over an entire season kind of thing.
It's by inch.
By inch for a particular storm. So, yeah. So what's the average storm? If you get over 12 inches, then we're going to pay you so much.
No, it's usually, and I don't know, could you shed some light on this? I've seen these policies, and what happens is, I'll give you for instance, a lot of contracts are written to a baseline.
Yeah, for instance, what's the baseline?
Well, it can be whatever you want it to be, and the premium's based on whatever.
Right, we don't know what that $14,000 represents for a baseline. That's my point.
That's why I'm asking for details. What usually happens is you establish a baseline, say 65 inches, 80 inches, usually see it in pieces like that. And as you go, you're say you have one for 65 that stops, usually that's a more expensive one, or 80, that's less money. So I'm sure there's some sort of a baseline on this.
Yeah.
But there generally is a savings if you hit that threshold. Like you say, there's nothing that's guaranteed with insurance. You all have insurance on your properties.
No, I think we have to wait for details.
So that's, if there are more details coming, but this would be my question to Selectman Bean.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you for joining us again. Do we have any knowledge, or have we heard anything about the funds that are due to come back to Hampton for the 2 days that were declared an emergency?
I don't think that's happening, and I wouldn't hold my
don't
breath, but I haven't heard anything different from the last time, and we've got.
Well, we were given 2 days, right, for the emergency?
We were given one storm.
We were given one storm, but 2 days.
Whatever that one storm took.
Well, the one storm, but, well.
It was 2 days long.
They gave it 2 days, so the expenses that were endured in those 2 days were days that were covered.
Right. There's nothing in the revenues, either the state or federal, that suggests they're in.
I think what we want is just status.
That's all we want, just
they're not in the
do we need to formalize the request, or can we just
that's what I'm asking.
What I'd like to do is send the town manager an email along with your schedule request, if that's okay.
No, I don't see any reason why you just can't take a team. I mean, you are the representative here.
I have a job. I'm going to email him in the morning.
An email, that's fine.
Are you going to?
He said he was.
I'm going to email him. I'll copy the chair. I'll do it in the morning. Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah.
I've spoken with the chairman, and he hasn't heard anything.
Okay.
So the request is it. Let's move
on. It's just a request, just to see.
It's not reflected in the September 2015 budget in terms of revenues from either the state.
No, we haven't heard anything about it yet, but I'm just wondering if it is coming in.
All right. Phil's got it on the sheet, and we'll just rely on him to get us that data. That's my opinion.
Quite honestly, if there was some validity to the insurance policy and you were looking for funding and that money comes in a timely manner, it would be a source of revenue. That's where I'm going with that direction. Okay, the minutes from, wait a minute, I won't go too far. I'm jumping over requests. This is our last opportunity for requests, although you now have the book. And the book is complete?
I have no idea.
It's complete except for the default budget.
No, but you know what? That was fast. They made the changes last night, as you saw.
I'm surprised we haven't.
And I wasn't really expecting it based on that until Friday.
Yeah, she says it's in her cover note, she says it's complete except for the default.
Doesn't have the warrant articles in it, of course.
Just the changes in the default.
Yeah.
What is currently on the table, Madam Chair? What are we doing?
Later.
Well, this is the first I'm looking at it, too, so.
It's a different format.
Yes. Lighter.
It's a very different format. And it's explained on the introductory page, Roman numeral 3.
All right, so let me ask you this. When we get those changes, will we then have these sheets redone with the default? We'll get a new set of inserts?
Yes, ma'am. That's my understanding. I just got a whole new bunch of replacements based on last night.
Okay. This is totally a different format, although Christina did spend some time working with Nate Lunny.
I see that.
And I think what you may find, and again, we just got these. I haven't even looked what you may find is a little bit more detail in this. All right.
Yeah,
so you have something to work with, and as soon as we have the default numbers, and that's only a few pages in the front, so that doesn't give me heartburn.
I thought she was going to put the default on each page.
Well, she does, but she doesn't have the default numbers in there. So
and she doesn't have lots. She doesn't have the budget either listed. I know, but all these pages don't have it.
Yeah, but these pages don't fall into here. So that's your actual
This is what we're missing here.
Yeah, that's what I was asking.
We're going to flip pages back and forth rather than having it on each page.
What
a pain in the ass.
Oh, we can pull them out, Mike. We'll have to pull them out. It's all
put them on the
table. What else we feel we need? I didn't expect
I don't know. I mean, it's I can see the backup data, though, is under the budget request, which helps.
That's a shot at you.
Well, what we need, obviously, Madam Chair.
You know what? You're going to need to look through the book.
We're going to need to look through this.
Even answer the next question.
But it's self-evident that what we need is a book that's complete. And it's pretty close to complete, but not yet complete.
Not yet complete. So. And when I put that on the agenda, actually, I thought we might have had the books before now, but we didn't. But I'm thankful that we do. All right.
As far as the schedule goes, I have a question.
Sure.
Under tonight, we were supposed to go to Rolling Stock.
Right.
Do you want to move that to another date?
No, the request was just that we have it. I believe it's in the book.
Okay.
This is DPW.
It's Rolling Stock, period.
Oh, okay.
And I believe it's in the book.
Yeah.
So the request was not to go through Rolling Stock, but to have Rolling Stock.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
So we still have stuff we want to ask for?
We do have. So is there anything else at this point that we've laid out on the table that we haven't requested? Stuff that I went through and corresponded, and stuff that we've cleared up here that we know we'll be hearing about dates for the tours of DPW and subcommittee for DPW. Do I have any other requests from any of the subcommittees? I think administration is happy right now. Okay, we'll
yes,
leave them
we
happy. And IT has had their opportunities and will give us a report. All right, and the last link on that one for the moment is library, and we've solved that. Or we know what the protocol is.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Any?
I've had some time the last couple of months, you know, as the selectmen have been going through the budget. It's a 165-page document that we have. It's been online for, you know, over a month, and they, you know, you could watch the meetings with them and go through the whole process. You know, one of the things that I've always done in businesses is compare the forecast for the year. You know, it doesn't really matter what the budget was for 2015, it's how you're going to finish and how much money are we asking for next year. It's going to be more than that or less than that. You know, how does your, because then you can lay out, you know, a 2014 total, a 13 total, 14 total, 15 forecast, and 16 budget. And that to me makes a lot of sense.
Yeah, you got continuity that way.
Yeah, and there's no place in our process that the controller goes, you know, puts together a forecast for the year, and I didn't know, is that something that we could ask for? I mean, unless it's part of her normal job, it's a big deal.
The budget, the 2016 budget will carry the forecast for next year. Mm-hmm. I'm on.
Yeah.
And then go?
No, the forecast for 2015.
That's covered. 15 is covered by your September report. Right, and then you can annualize the line items.
Well, that's something that there's 3 months left to annualize, you know, and...
October, November, December, but some of them are not annualizable because they're not linear.
Well, that's, and I don't know enough about it to do that.
Like, linear, I don't know about the debt, you're right.
I've taken a look at that, the 9 months.
We could ask that of Christie, but I would say, do you want that line by line, or would you be happy with it department by department?
I think she would have to do it line by line in order to generate it, so I'd rather have that data, but I take it by department.
For 2015?
Yeah, for 2015, it just would be nice to have a number that she's happy with, so we can say the 2016 budget represents what percent increase over what we actually spent this year with that horrific snowball expense.
Well, I can offer you my book from last year to go through it.
Sunny?
Yeah, what he's talking about is normally you would have the 2015 budget items in a separate column, so you compare the two.
Right.
That's all.
Exactly.
This is the 2016 budget.
I'm not looking for 2015 budget. I'm not communicating this very well.
Yeah. You're looking to see what we're going to end up with.
What's our projected actual 15 expense?
Yeah. They're not going to be able to exceed the money we budgeted for.
No, but what he's looking for is, at this point,
to compare
most places where you budget, when you get into the fourth quarter, you should be able to have a good best guesstimate, is what I call it, in forecasting where you're going to end up.
Well,
because you're going to start to hold the line.
But essentially, they're 75% spent through September.
Yeah, you're 75% spent. But
yeah, the budget's 75% spent. They're actually 74.3%. So they're $120,000 under what they're projected. And revenue-wise, they're $320,000 over. So it would be nice to see the total of the revenue and the expenses. Where do you think you're going to end up, and how does 16 compare to
that? That's the kind of granularity that I mean, Fred did say last night that from here on in, every PO is going to be watched very carefully.
I did hear it.
So that here's 75% spent right now, they're going to be coming close to budgeted amounts.
And quite honestly, one storm can throw, we're getting to a real fine line now, that one storm can throw all of that totally off. But we can ask, and generally when we get into, and you guys know this, generally when we get into December, we're getting a generalized forecast of where we're going to come in. Not department by department, but usually they'll start to throw out numbers like, well, we anticipate being, you know, 200,000 over or 300,000 over, but I think this year it's going to be pretty tight. Tim?
Keep in mind, Scott, that we don't do any final decision-making on any of the line items in the budget until our final review in January, in which we'll have the complete, or ought to have the complete 2015 expenditures at that point in time. I'm a little reluctant to burden the administration with the extra task of doing a forecast to satisfy us rather than their own management needs. I'm sure they're forecasting for the management needs right now. I don't find a compelling need to get that forecast because it is just a forecast. I'd rather see actuals, which we ought to have in January prior to our making our final review. So that would be my thoughts.
Yeah, I'll go with that. I don't want to burden her with a lot of extra
Let me solve it this way. Going forward now, you have your books, and when we start to get into the sessions, everything becomes a lot clearer as we go along, and you will have very specific questions, not these broad-based questions. The one thing, we've already determined that any questions that anyone has on this committee will filter to me and then to the town manager. What I would ask you to do is that you compartmentalize the questions and send it to me in a way that, let's say, fire questions aren't mixed with police questions. Send me just fire questions because I can take that document as it is and just send it to Fred. Otherwise, I have to break it down and send it, say, okay, these are the fire questions. See what I'm saying? So just try to
a separate page for each department.
A separate page for each department, and then that way it can just be sent on much faster than if somebody has to break them down. Okay?
Now we'll copy the rest of the words. If
at this point, any questions that are asked, and answered. We'll be copying everybody on, all right? Michael?
Yes, I don't know if this answers Scott's question or not, but there is a year-end projection right here by 71 to 71.5K. We're under that, but if you move that on the end of the year, you're going to be pretty tight based on that alone.
Yeah, that's actual through September.
That's what she says there, right?
Yeah, through September.
So that would give you a ballpark idea of where we are in relation to that, but
yep.
Then you have to mix in the flavor that your expenses usually go down in the next couple of months towards the end of the year, so you might end up with more than that. But this is the best you're going to get that we've ever had historically. And what you're asking for is a little different, I know that, but
yeah, I think we passed it.
Yeah. Yep. Now, I have one other question. Are you going to go over the September financials tonight?
Yeah.
When do you want to do that?
We can do that under new business.
Okay, how about official request from the Budget Committee to the town, the selectman or the town manager?
We're doing that now.
Okay. We're all across it now.
Okay, well, I'd like to make a motion on that, because I'd like to obtain forthwith the Excel file that was utilized to produce the budget books. Last year, I paid $50 for that book, and I didn't get the default budget even when they said they'd give it to me for $50. Okay? The default budget was never delivered to me as the part of the $50 arrangement. The Budget Committee has the authority to obtain this authority under Municipal Budget Law 3222, and if they don't, you can look at 23. So I think it's very important for us to have the Excel file based on what I've seen so far, this interesting production here. So I think it's going to be very crucial for people who really dig into the numbers to have the Excel file.
So you people that, you know, can sit at home and play around right. with what this reduction might do, what this addition might do, because the math is already baked into the table, so to speak.
Right. Like yeah, for yourself.
I'd second yeah. a conversation on that, at least.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right, I'm going to open it up for conversation. By hands.
I think I know what Mike is driving at, and I don't disagree. It gives some insight for people that want to exercise that spreadsheet to see what the impact is of maybe some suggestions they might have in terms of gas and diesel or whatever else. So
it'd just be easier to formulate it too. But it's easier to plug numbers into Excel. It seems like a very useful tool in helping come up with some models for us.
Yeah,
and it's easier to
work some numbers.
If you're doing it on your computer, you go through a myriad of pages if it's a PDF. And then you're only guessing when you go to page 52 if that's where you want to be. However, if it's an Excel spreadsheet or a book, as they might call it, it's right there, just like this. It's just almost identical to this.
Yeah. Well, my question is, can this be sent in a file or does this have to be printed?
Oh, no, we don't want to print it, because that's the problem. When they print it, they make it a PDF.
Electronic file.
Electronic file.
Digital file should be emailed, in my opinion. Should be we all have email addresses on the committee. So everyone on the committee should be emailed a copy of the Excel spreadsheet. If they don't want to look at it, they don't have to look at it.
Okay. Stephen, you were saying something? No? Okay, I'm sorry.
I did take the budget, the $23,558,000. $558,000 without debt that was on the website, and I dropped that in by line item, by department. So I have it in Excel. I mean, it's very tedious to go through, but I would rather
why we want the Excel so that we don't have to go through that tedium to do those kind of exercises.
Right. So what I'm going to do now is update it for these new numbers from last night. Just a few accounts that
save
changed.
Yourself some time and wait for the Excel
Scott,
file.
So you can find the Excel.
I would find it. I would rather have it from them because it has the account numbers on it and all of that.
Yeah, yeah,
it's
right.
much better. But first come to shove, I've got something that we could work with. I'm just saying.
I would observe also that the length of time that we spent talking about it so far exceeds the length of time it will take Christy to email it to us.
Okay. That being said, gentlemen, we're going back and forth. We had all agreed. Hands. All right. Thank you, Brian.
I don't want anybody to get crazy, but I've been requesting this for 4 years,
okay.
And ended up creating my own every year. So I'm just saying,
that's public information.
Don't count.
Right.
I'm just saying I've been through this road
down the road.
All right, well, let's try to shorten it.
Let's be clear on this.
We have a motion on the table, we have a second. Is there anybody who wants to speak who has not spoken about it? Who has not spoken about it? Yes?
Yes. I want to respond to what Brian just said. I believe that Mr. Pierce referenced RSA 32:22 in his request. That is a formal request. By law, they must supply it, period. There is no may I please involved here. We're not begging. We're simply asking for the law to be followed.
And I've asked.
Well, asking isn't different than requesting under the duties of the law.
Well, let's give it some teeth. All those in favor of this request? Anyone opposed? Anyone abstaining? You're abstaining.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you. All right. We have everyone in favor here tonight, with the exception of Selectman Bean, who is abstaining. We have no votes to the negative.
Well, that's already accounted for.
That message, just two?
Two. Well, one.
That Glenn and the West.
Yeah. So we have 12-0-1, correct? All right.
Madam Chair.
Right.
Yes.
A year and a half ago, we had the former finance director, Mike Swatzer, give us a list of all of the funds in the town and their present status.
Okay.
That was a year and a half ago. I'd like to see that list updated. I don't know that we need to come and make a presentation. I'm just happy with this is the fund, this is the source of the fund, this is how much money we got, this is the authority to add to or withdraw from.
Yeah, correct.
Basically four or five columns.
If I'm wrong, we got that from Mike Schwarzer, or did we get that from the treasurer?
We got it from Mike Schwarzer.
Yeah.
He did make reference to the treasurer in his presentation.
All right.
No, not all the funds are held by Silver.
Okay. No. So you want...
I want all the funds.
All the funds.
We have them.
Silverdick, or the trustees of trust fund, they should be listed under who's the custodian of the fund.
Okay.
But the town finance director ought to have, as Mike Schwarzer did, an entire list of all the funds.
Okay. Including North.
Madam Chair.
Easy enough. We've gotten those in the past.
That was last year.
Yes, Sonny.
Yep. You got it?
Yeah. If you look at page 3II, it says the appendix section. Currently does not include the default budget. It is still being prepared and is expected to be reviewed by the Board of Selectmen next Monday. Once it's completed, it will be forwarded to the Budget Committee.
Yeah, okay.
For insertions.
But you'll have to take pages out and put the new pages in. So, because we want to see it all together.
Now, Madam Chairman, on the 29th of October, you have all these.
Did you get a decision on my request for the funds?
Yeah, we said.
Okay,
you want
thank
to put
you.
It in a motion, or I'm just going
to
request it.
I'll leave that to you, Madam Chair, as to the proper way of handling it.
That we've done in the past. I don't see a reason to.
Fine. No problem.
Go crazy on that one.
I'm happy to have that in digital form, by the way.
Okay. Now, on the 29th of October, there's 7 departments due to come in, and I'm not sure that. Are they going to still? Are we still planning on bringing them all in?
Well, one of them is the Budget Committee. Then we're going to do our budget and under new business. Okay, so now we're down to 6. One moment.
I don't think.
Patriotic purposes and town beautification. If you can't do that,
on your own.
Yeah, exactly. And
you don't belong here.
So I don't think you're overworked in that section.
No, I'm just saying. Who do we really? We want the town clerk here, that's for sure. The tax collector, too, I think.
And I think it's probably, I'll put it under new business, but I've got a commercial as far as coming in here, as far as who we're actually going to need to bring in. I'll talk more under new business when we get through this.
Excuse me, yes.
Yeah, because I think that's where we might be going with
it.
Okay,
gotcha.
But I can't even give you the answers until we look through the books and look at the budgets.
Yeah.
Tim.
I do have a kind of motion on how we proceed that I'd like to get entertained. It speaks to at least the part which Joe is referring to. I'm hoping you afford me that opportunity at this point to do that since he brought up the topic.
You're taking my new business away from me, but that's okay.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
All right. Go ahead.
You know, last year was a different year, and we're looking for new ways of improving things, making things more streamlined, but not losing the essence of what our job is. One of the things we've already done is not do these round table things, which was a considerable waste of time. Sort of raising the hand and getting the floor from the chair has proven, in my opinion, to save a considerable time already. I assume that we will continue with that practice. In addition to that, I think that last year, and as all the years previously, every time we've had a department come in here with a line item, there's been a motion for the line item, and then a second on the line item, then a discussion on the line item, and then a vote on the line item. And of course, last year caused considerable angst among some of the department heads, because somehow in the minutes it said that our motion was to send the line item to the deliberative session. So naturally, those who were watching assumed that we'd approve that line item. So when we made adjustments, naturally that was a bit upsetting. Completely understandable. It's in our control to prevent that kind of misunderstanding by making sure that our minutes are accurate, but also by either making a motion to consider it favorably or unfavorably at final review, or have no motion at all. We're under no obligation to make a motion every time a department comes in here. We can just let them explain their situation and say, thank you very much. We'll take that under advisement when we do our final review. So that's part of my thought on the matter. The other part is that, it's my opinion, we've had people coming in here that just don't need to be in here. Patriotic Purposes is a great example. But there are many others. And so then the question becomes, well, what objective criteria can we employ to prevent people wasting their time? And I would suggest the following criteria. If a given line item is at or near flat in terms of its budget request, and no budget committee member has any questions that would require an interactive nature to be answered, then that line item need not be formally presented. We can just go with the numbers. So, in the case of the town clerk, for example, that may be something where we want to have an interactive with. I'm sure one or two or more of us want to have that, so we'll want to have her in. Mm-hmm. But in terms of the others, I think for the most part, we don't even have questions. We all just kind of make a little speech or, you know, say how wonderful they are or whatever. It's just a lot of waste of time. The selectmen do a great job telling people they do a great job, so we don't need to be redundant in that area.
I'll second that motion.
Well, is the wording... No, wait a minute.
Frazier
that motion is three paragraphs long. So could we have it...
But it was descriptive, wasn't it?
10 words or less.
Why don't you break it up into pieces parts?
Like, yeah, let's start with the last one. We'll do a couple motions then. The last one is that I move that we do not invite anyone in here who has a flat budget, and no budget committee has questions of an interactive nature to engage them with. Oh, they can still submit written questions.
I'll second
that.
Okay. All right. Okay. And Mike, you seconded that?
Yes, ma'am.
So, motion by Tim Jones and seconded by Michael.
Again, you'll need some discussion.
And yes, discussion from those who have not discussed it.
One reason we have each of the department heads come in is to educate us and educate the community. If you just because they have a flat budget doesn't mean you don't discuss it.
So just to be clear, if you want them to come in as a budget committee member, then they'll come in. That simple.
All it takes is one person,
I guess. Right.
Or one person putting a question in or two questions in, and then the person has to come in?
That's right. One person. One budget committee member says, I want them in here. I have interactive questions I want to engage them with.
Okay.
That's it. No discussion. They're coming in.
Somebody who hasn't spoken. Scott.
I haven't watched the selectman meeting. I certainly agree with your motion. And those meetings are available on file if you want to see what they said about the beautification of the patriotic causes or the animal control or... And how good a job they're doing, you can see that. You know?
And, you know, certainly they only need to come in once and do that, Sonny. I think that Scott's right in that regard. There's a video record, and we can always refer people to it. I can think of some instances right off the top of my head. The welfare department. Welfare officer doesn't have to come in here, because by law, it wouldn't matter what she put in the budget. Whatever she needs to spend, she needs to spend. It's one of those areas that it just doesn't, not that it, welfare doesn't matter, not that she doesn't matter, not that she doesn't mm-hmm. do a wonderful job, but after working all day, this is the last place she needs to come to tell us nothing that really can be changed, okay?
And she does an excellent job besides.
And she does an excellent job besides. So we have a few instances of that from what I've watched from the selectmen's meetings, where we have something that is flat, or one question might answer the whole issue, and we can keep these sessions from going on past 11 o'clock like last year. You know, we heard some of the complaints from last year, and this is trying to tune some of that up and make the budget process a little bit more palatable and a little bit more user-friendly and a little bit more interactive between those who really have to put this together. So you have a question, Brian?
One problem I have is over the years, we've always had these people come in, and one of the main reasons was it was just flat. Okay, yep, we're going to get $15,000 this year, every year. Well, did you spend $15,000? Did you not spend $15,000? The reason we have them come in here is so that we can review that line item mm-hmm. and make sure that we're just not flipping money out. And I'm not saying that we are in any way, shape, or form.
Are you talking about anything?
But anything, I'm talking about at all.
Oh, okay.
All right. Well, I'll remind you that if you want them to come in, as one budget committee member, you can say,
I understand that, okay. But I just, that's my reasoning behind it, is because I hate to see things, okay, next year's budget committee is going to end up with this, and the year after, oh, well, they passed it, they didn't have a problem. Well, we never looked at it.
Well, it's up to us to review that thing ahead of time, mm-hmm. if he's flat,
absolutely,
and he makes sense with his budget, and there's no historical footprints in place where he should be lower,
mm-hmm.
I don't need to talk to the guy.
Mm-hmm.
If the person's got some increases in the budget and historical footprint doesn't match, he's coming in or she's coming in.
As long as we all understand that.
Right. We all have to do our homework at home.
Right.
Not when they're in here and at that time we're looking at it for the first time. That's out.
Yep.
Do your homework at home. Come in prepared.
Remember, it only takes one of us to say, I want them in. They don't have to justify their reason. Just, I want them in.
Mm-hmm. Does anybody else, with a hand up, might add, have a question? No? All right, so we have a motion. We have a second. We've had our discussion. All those in favor of this motion?
I'm in favor.
Opposed? And abstentions. So we have all in favor except for Brian and for Sonny, and no abstentions.
My other motion minute.
So, excuse me 1 minute. We have a vote of 11-0, correct? And I'm repeating this again for the benefit of our secretary.
My other motion I'm a little flexible on, and maybe I'm asking for simply a discussion, and I'm not sure. But when we have departments come in, if we're going to make a motion, we ought to make a motion to be favorable or unfavorably considered in our final review. Or we shouldn't have a motion at all.
Well, I'd like to speak to that before we make a motion.
I want to avoid that angst that was generated last year, and I believe rightfully so, because when I was breathed some fire on over by a certain department heads, they were absolutely right. I told them they were absolutely right. When I checked the minutes, it said what it said. And we approved those minutes, and we blew it. We just blew it as a committee.
Well, you have your...
We blew it as a committee because no one on the committee actually ever made a motion to move it to deliberative session, those line items. But that's what the minutes said.
Yes, we did.
No, we only said move. I moved the number. I moved the number.
Been in the minutes, but
I'm going to jump in here.
All right. Go ahead, Eileen.
Again, in correcting some missteps of last year, and don't forget, we've been following like lemmings from one year to the next, the same process. Mm-hmm. Sometimes it doesn't work. all right? When we saw that $2 million wasn't going to go to the voters last year and have them say yes, all right, we took a line that we would have to make some radical choices, and we did. We took the flak for it, but by the representation in the voting booth, we weren't off our mark. So we're hoping, I'm hoping this year we have a different process, all right? We look at this budget fairly with all the work that's gone into it. Remember, our job isn't always to slice and dice, I for lack of a better term, but you know what I mean when I say that. It's to decide whether or not something is warranted. There are times, and there are many times in this committee, that we took very unpopular lines on the beginning. I go back to the first year I was here. This committee fought for a fire boat. Nobody wanted it. It has saved a lot of lives. We got it, and that was a battle that took the whole season, and it was the budget committee that kept going back to it and putting that discussion on the table. When it came to having half of the Uptown Fire Station built, it was the budget committee that kept that conversation alive and said, no, we need one down the beach, but we need the whole station uptown, not built in two different parts. I think people forget that. When we had an 11th hour crisis in a budget, and we had to put a new pump station in for an estimate over $4 million, and let me tell you, that was an 11th hour. It was the budget committee that endorsed that project. So there are many times that while we seem to slice and dice that budget and trim it and do what we feel we need to do for the taxpayers, we also go out there and we put ourselves out there and we say we do need those projects. This is going to be one of those years. If you listen last night, the budget is very close, but there's a big divide between the default budget and the proposed budget, all right? That if there's things in there that we need, then we need to fight for them. But we need to decide what it is that we have to put in that budget to fight for. And that's our job, all right? How I'd like to, and this is my conversation with the rest of you, where we went wrong last year is we did move by a vote and seem to approve. However, we did always have the right of review. And what we did was we approved department by department, which in the department itself may have been reasonable, but when you got to the end and you put it all together, we couldn't afford it. So we had to, in a review, find ways to bring that down. This year, I think to get out of that trap, if we go at a different set of motions that opens the budget up for consideration and demonstration, actually, by the department heads, and leave that as an open, I'll get the wording correct by the time we have our first meeting. I'm working on that right now because I want it to be correct. But in other words, roll from one meeting to the next with no final decision, department by department, line by line, until we get to final review. Give the departments the opportunity to come in here, discuss with us what they feel they need. The town manager is usually with us. Christie is usually with us for questions. And it's more of a question, but not a decision making. You'll come out of these with questions, I'm sure. But then when we get to the two-session review, that'll be an active review. And hard decisions on the department expenses will be made by then. Michael.
Just make a motion to move it to the review. How simple can it get?
I said I'm so okay. I'm okay either way.
Remove consideration to the review.
Okay. Oh, whatever.
Okay.
Favorable.
Well, the only thing is, Mike, on that is, what happens if there's two or three or four line items that you're not comfortable with? You didn't get the answers.
Well, you have the ability to ask the questions in that session, Jerry.
Yeah, but it may
okay?
not be answered.
And then you have from there till review to make your personal decision on it based on the
information. You have to come back with further information.
All we're going to do is defer
Final
judgment to the review.
I agree.
So in other words, we're not going to have anybody walking out with a yes or a no in that session.
Yes.
Give us your best foot forward, give us your best argument for these expenses, and we'll consider them. That doesn't mean that you should not be taking heavy notes through this session and checking off the things that you're fine with, all right, and making notes on the things that you're not. Now, this is a little radical from the way we've done things, because usually we walk out at the end of the night and, all right, this section is done. So this is where the consideration by the rest of you comes in, because you won't necessarily be done. But that may be a better course than to be done and then go into review and open it up again. Because I guarantee, especially based on what I saw last night with the insurance, that things are going to pop in and out. Like I said, we're running so thin this year, we may get to the end of the year with a snowstorm that throws everything out the window. So,
I will second Mr. Pierce's motion. Didn't you just make a motion?
No, Mr. Jones made the motion. I second it.
Okay.
Did I?
That works fine.
Okay, motion?
Did he make the motion, did I?
Well, I think
he did.
He did.
No,
made the motion initially.
I'm willing to yield.
There is no motion on the table.
I yield to Mr. Pierce's motion.
So,
well,
Michael?
Eileen is the one who made the motion.
I don't make motions, but you want to give us a motion on this?
Yes, I think we should, at the end of each department or section, rather than giving a... moving our decision to the deliberation session, I think we should drop that deliberation session, and the motion should read something like, we move this discussion to
move
our final
consideration to final review.
Yeah, final
review.
Do you plan on voting with that motion?
I don't know how else do you want me to say it.
Well, I would suggest that you say the motion should be to remove X amount for favorable consideration at our final review. That way people can vote favorably or unfavorably, but it's not a decision.
No, I don't want to vote.
No.
Well, that's why I asked if his motion was about a vote, and he said yes, I thought.
I don't think we need a dollar value.
Great, we're not going to vote. That's great.
He's moving the decision.
And it's moving the decision to the final review.
Moving the decision to final review.
Sorry, I was confused. I love that. Thank you.
Do I have a second on that?
It hurts.
Scott, thank you.
Oh, kind.
All right. I think we had the discussion on it.
Yes.
Unless somebody didn't say anything. Okay. All those in favor? Wow, really?
Really.
Unanimous.
It's a better way.
Okay, did you have more, Mr. Jones?
Yes.
All right.
Well, let's the public know that, yes, we are going to wait till the final review. Last year we got in trouble for it, and for no reason, because that's
all right.
The rules.
It's good that we're recognizing areas of improvement and taking action in regards to that. It's just good stuff, always.
Moving on to the next area that I have a question in.
One more thing.
You can, but I want to do this one first. Following up on last night, I'm very happy, Selectman Bean, that town manager came back with revisions on the fuel costs. Was $36,000, $37,000 downward?
Number,
yeah, mid-30s downward on the fuel cost. The only question I would have, and I won't put this on you, I'll direct it myself to the town manager, is I'm unclear whether we are buying from the state for the entire year, or if we're buying it at the pump, because we had this discussion last year and we were informed that there is a process by which if the price is lower, we can buy gas at the pump. And we can also apply for the tax portion to come back to us, which is what, about 40 cents
a gallon from what I can see on the Google.
At 207 or 210 a gallon.
205 this morning at S.
Speedway. Right. Well, when you take the 40 cents down, then you're talking about, you know, roughly $1.70.
Yeah.
All right, for gas. And if we're paying the state's price of $3.30 something, there's a little bit of a difference.
Yeah, I
know. If we're talking about every vehicle. And I don't know. So it's okay with the board. I'm going to ask that question on how we're buying it, because there may be an avenue for further reduction there. I know it's a lot more work, but I think that it's worth it.
We go through the state.
You want a motion on that?
Yeah, you can give me a motion on that.
Madam Chairman, I move that we ask you, the chairman, to ascertain whether the town can buy the gasoline to pump or they have to stick to the $3.
You already know that they don't have to.
Right.
They answered it last year.
No, the thing is not if they have to, but how they're doing it. How much of this year's gas was purchased through the state and how much was purchased.
So you want to know how much they're actually buying at the pump rather than.
Right.
If I recall the discussion, he said they buy it all through the state contract, otherwise they have to pay the gas tax and then file for an abatement.
He said that they're buying it all through the state. Did I get that right, Mr. Bean?
Yes, you did.
Aren't we buying everything through the state?
It was a big discussion. You know what? This could just be clarified in one.
Okay, well, I make the motion.
And the cut was $37,000.
On the subject and where they're buying the gas and if we have to buy it from the state. There you go.
I don't think we have to buy it from the state.
Do I have a second on that?
Oh, yeah, I'll second that. I think that we need a lot of, I'm still very unsettled on that.
And further discussion from anybody who has not discussed it? Tim?
Under Appendix G in your book, there are several subsections, the last of which, the last page prior to the index, actually delineates Christie's analysis of the gas costs for 2015 and 2014.
Wait a minute, where the hell is that?
Last page prior to the index. And she shows you how she arrived at average cost per gallon, both for gasoline and for diesel.
Appendix G, huh?
Yeah, the last page before the
index. Oh, here it is, yeah.
Last page before the index.
I don't have anything in Appendix G.
Just keep turning the page. Yeah,
right after this amber color.
Go to the
after
index.
The yellow?
Go to the amber and the blue.
Go to the index and turn back one page.
Yeah.
Keep going. Stuff will be up to
it. Now, the town manager did say last year that he can buy gas anywhere he wants to. And he did say, I believe last night, Mr. Bean, you can correct me if I'm mistaken in my memory, but he said that the budget figure is based on the state rate, using as a rate the average cost per gallon on this sheet.
This doesn't
that sound
answer.
Familiar, Mr. Bean?
Generally, but I'm okay. With the chair that we're going to get clarification.
Yeah, I think it's easy enough to get clarification, and this doesn't tell it who, it gives us how it was derived, but
well,
not who we're getting it.
Then, Madam Chair, if Mr. Bean is in favor of getting the information, I don't think we need a motion. Let's just let him get it.
We have a motion, and we have a second.
Yeah, we already have that.
We have that out there. It's not for you to
say. Just
trying to save time.
All right.
All in favor?
All those in favor? Okay, opposed? Abstain. All right, so we have one vote no and from Brian and one abstention.
Two.
From Tim and who else? Sonny.
Mr. Kravitz.
Okay. Appreciate that.
Now, if I may.
You have another request?
Yes. The
okay.
Request is that since we've decided on. An objective protocol or objective criteria about deciding who to come in, who not to come in. And our next meeting actually has scheduled people to come in. But we ought to go through each of those items and see which of them, based on our criteria, that we actually want to come in.
We ought to decide that at our next meeting, you mean?
We decided at this meeting for our next meeting.
We can do that under new business.
That's fine. Thank you.
Why can't we do that at home? I mean,
we can't vote at home.
What?
We can't vote at home.
Oh, no, but we can say, you said if one person wants them in, then they're coming in. So I think we should have a chance to review this and send the chair an email. And if she gets an email from someone, then they could be coming in.
You know
in.
What? In all honesty, I don't think there's anybody there that you'll be taking off that list. The Board of Selectmen, the Budget Committee, you're not going to take yourselves off the list.
Mm-hmm.
Town Clerk, Tax Collector. Town beautification and patriotic purposes is usually put out there by the town manager.
The only one you could take off the list is the Budget Committee.
And the Conservation Commission, which we won't even need to do because we're going to do that under new business tonight. Our budget is three lines long. How long you want to talk about it?
Well, we can take off patriotic purposes at least.
Huh?
Patriotic purposes.
Well, nobody comes in under patriotic purposes.
Well, it's not entertained, is all I'm saying, whether the person's here or not.
All right, so we're done, I think. Next week, you're all set. Beyond that, will take some going through the budget book.
I'll have to decide that at the next meeting.
But you can decide that at the next meeting.
Right.
Okay?
Thank you.
Eileen, one more comment on the gas and diesel prices.
Yeah.
The prices in these, in this book, does it reflect the 40 cent a gallon deduction, or is it, is that 40 cents?
Not from what I can see on those numbers.
I mean,
I mean, I'll ask.
Yeah, these numbers are high, relatively speaking.
Yeah.
So,
These are the state numbers, Jerry, you gotta keep that in mind.
No, but I mean, when we buy it, are we getting the 40 cent a gallon reduction? And are these figures here?
Yes, if you're buying it from the state, you don't pay the 40 cents.
If you look at January 15, it's $1.72 a gallon for gasoline.
What?
In January 15, it shows $1.72 per gallon for gasoline.
Yeah?
Yep.
Average cost per gallon of this.
Right.
If they get a contract and they sign it for a year and it's $3 a gallon, it doesn't go down to $1.72 in the middle of the winter.
Well, for some reason, it had quite a dip in January, for some reason.
Well, the state average in January was 218, slightly above 218.
We may want to have...
So, that. I mean, I don't know what this represents. I
don't know what it represents. So I mean, I'm just looking at, say, August, where gasoline down here is 267. If you bought it at the pump with 40 cents taken out for taxes, we probably would have been better off at the pump. That's the only, that's where the question lies. So you know what, we can go around with it, but we don't know, so let me ask the question, and we can definitely get an answer and know what we're dealing with, because gasoline isn't something we have to struggle with through every single department. I'm sure when we get to review,
we have to understand what our baseline is.
Exactly. So by the time we get there, that will be evident.
Madam Chair, one final information request.
Mm-hmm.
The last meeting we had, we requested, or rather in January's meeting, or July's meeting, we requested 5 years snow and ice abatement expenses. We did receive a response from the finance director on that, and I did review it, and I believe actually the law requires the committee to review it, you know. Since we requested it, we have to review it by law. And I do have some questions about that, and I'm not sure quite how to proceed with those questions.
Yeah, let's put that on. How many questions? How long is that going to take? And is this something that we're going to redirect as questions? In other words, the answers to the questions that we got. These new questions?
Well, the questions relative to the answers, for example, there were 5 years depicted as requested, plus the current 2015. But in that six-year period, there was only 1 year in which any, and I know this is Jerry's job to pound sand, but I'm going to do it, I guess.
Leave my sand alone.
There was only 1 year in which there was expenditures for sand, and it was a relatively small amount. And that's kind of a major curiosity to me, how that could happen. And then the other one was, the sand was actually accounted for under an account number very different than account number delineated in the 2015 budget book. So I don't understand that discrepancy.
I would say the additional questions generated from the answers that you received from the initial questions, put those in an email with reference to the areas that you think they're linked to. And I'm sure we'll send that to me in an email. I'll forward that get an answer on it.
We'll do, Madam Chair. Thank you.
Jerry?
Yeah, I got that, this Tristy sent us from 2010 to through August of 15.
Right.
I went back to 2007. I put another 3 years on there. 9 years total, I looked
at.
Yeah,
but we didn't ask her for that, Jerry.
I know, but I'm trying to determine, because I wanted to see where the range was.
Yeah.
Because I want to be looking at the DPW department and see how they're going to budget for this snow business. So what I came up with is, if you took the high year, you know, if you counted all 9 years, and you said the average came out to $173,464, if all 9 years were counted, that's how much we spent in those categories she has listed. But if you throw out the high year and you throw out the low year, it came out 159. So we're somewhere between 159, 160, and 173 in terms of how that line item could be budgeted, in my opinion. And that's where I think I'm, that's how that's going to be translated.
Was there a mention last night, Selectman Bean, of assault by?
I don't recall.
I wanted.
Oh, no, they did have a, they talked about $58 going to $60 per ton.
Yeah, but it's going up $50.
Yeah, they're going to be nice.
And there was a total given, wasn't there?
That shed only holds a half a year.
I can't remember the total.
Okay, let's do this. Let's, the further questions that we have, put them in an email, send them to me. Christie has been very good so far in responding to the written questions. Like to just keep that going, okay?
Sounds good.
All right, now, moving on, the minutes of September 15th. Do we have?
Were they emailed?
Huh, yes.
Yeah, I never received them.
Who else didn't get them?
I got them.
You got them.
The draft minutes were sent on 9/23.
Thank you, Dave.
Thank you.
I never thought.
What are we talking about?
You had to turn your.
Our minutes?
The minutes of all.
Oh, yeah, I mean, I got them, they were in here.
Okay.
There were some areas that needed, I believe, some touch-up in there.
Why we're going through them? That's what we're here for you.
Speak now or forever hold your peace.
Maureen, I know you've missed us.
Madam Chair, in regards to the minutes that were sent.
Yep.
I suggest that perhaps the recorder puts page numbers on them so that when we go to review them, we can say page three, et cetera.
Good idea.
Very good idea.
Yes.
You've done this before.
All right. Okay. All right. First page, which is basically just all names. Any corrections on that one?
What is the date on that?
September 15th. Okay. All right. Second page, beginning with we finished. Any corrections on that one? Third page, beginning with Jim. Yes.
On the third page, it says Mr. Jones asked about enrollment, and that was actually Mr. LaBranch that asked about enrollment.
Mm. What?
Mm. Yeah, but you read my mind, Steve.
I'm on the wrong page. Am I out of order?
See, without page numbers, it's well, difficult.
Yeah, I know.
Mr. Jones? What's the first line on the paragraph?
Mr. Jones.
Mr. Jones.
Mr. Jones.
If you printed it out, it's right next to the second to last paragraph.
Yeah, okay. All right, that's on the third page.
You just out of order.
Yeah. Page four. Page five.
No, being no further business, meeting was adjourned at 9:13.
You went all the way to the end.
Oh, I'm
on
sorry.
Five. Six? Seven? Does anybody else have any corrections? All right. Jordan?
Yes. I have.
What?
I have one correction at the end.
Yep.
Meeting was adjourned at 9:13. It was, the motion was by Steve. It was seconded by Mike Pierce.
Okay.
Because there was a vote taken.
All right.
And I did review it.
And I didn't vote.
TY, that's the person taking the minutes.
Yes. She does the she does the silicon.
I think she did an excellent job.
You're right.
Terry Eaton.
All right.
I'm not done that.
All right, we actually got through that one.
Madam Chair.
Oh, yes,
well, we've decided you want to vote, don't pay off.
Yeah. Can I have a motion to accept the minutes?
I would motion to accept the minutes as corrected.
All second. Right, Nick.
Second.
By Mr. Pierce.
All those in favor? Opposed? Abstentions? Maureen.
And Mike. And Mike Plouffe.
Maureen Buckley and Mike Plouffe abstain.
think there was a paragraph in there that said something about, was the school, did the school intend to sell some land? And it's referred to as land in Southampton. I don't think the Hampton School District owns any.
Southampton? Oh, okay.
That was in the draft minutes that I read.
Yeah.
But I don't know if they've been corrected or not since then.
I'll go back and scrub it.
We own land on.
It is on page three, right above where Mr. LaBranche was talking about the enrollment. It's the paragraph directly above it. And I believe Mr. Ladd was asking about the property in West Hampton.
Yes.
Which would be Bachelor's Pond.
Bull Farm Road, right.
Yeah, Bull Farm Road.
Western, Mr. Hampton, not West Hampton.
We should probably say the West End of Hampton and not the West Hampton. We don't think the West, we're creating a new town. Although maybe we'd like that.
Property on Toll Farm Road.
You know, yeah, exactly.
They've already been approved as corrected, Madam Chair.
Thank you. All right, I'm going to go through the three representatives with reports, but only as they regard to anything of monetary value that we will be dealing with, which might make these reports very, very short. The first one, Maureen, is there?
The only thing I want to say is we have yet to really put together our budget. We're going to meet with certain factions. The fireworks, for example, is coming up. We have, we're going to check to see what we can do there. They had a three-year contract, I believe. Is that right, Steve? Yeah, and that's up this year. And I'm meeting with some of the bands to talk about next year and the Hampton talent and how we can work on that, too. So before we do all these meetings, then we'll put together the budget.
Okay, so you're a work in progress.
Indeed.
Okay. Selectman Bean.
What about it? Excuse me. You want to talk about the Christmas break?
No.
You want to mention, you made a motion about that.
You have a 30-minute dissertation.
To be in the, yeah. Oh, I guess, what does that have to do with money?
It's only $2,000.
She said money. We're going to be in the Christmas parade, in case anybody cares.
$2,000. You actually did make a motion for money regarding the Christmas parade.
That's because you told me to. But basically, we are, that's, we're going to do that. We're going to go, we were in it last year as well, but this year we're going to do something a little different. But we will be in there, and I don't know.
And it was very nice.
Thank you so much.
Up to $2,000, I recall.
Yeah, I think that's about right. Isn't that where we are again?
That's going to work fine.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you.
Are you two kids done?
Yeah, it does.
Selectman Bean.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you, Madam Chair. Just real quickly, things that popped out to me last night personally was the increase in the health insurance, which boosted essentially a flat budget up to a 1% increase on that line item alone. The property casualty insurance is, of course, up in Concord. That PLT is a wobbly platform, and if we have to move from that, that indeed as well could be a pop. That we must consider. If the line is at 300,000 and we take a 20% increase of 15, that's $45,000-$50,000. And finally, the New Hampshire retirement system with that turbulent summer, there may be an increase coming forward from them as they set their rate next year. So those are three items that we don't have a lot of control over, but I think we need to be aware of our budget.
I have a question for you.
Yes,
maybe
ma'am.
You can answer and maybe you can't. I know that under the setup now, there are different companies that we can buy from through the trust. And I'm wondering why it is that the schools seem to have their costs contained and they actually decreased while ours are increasing. Are there choices that they have that we don't have?
You know, I don't have granularity on the subject. I do know this, that the municipal platform in terms of government is somewhat more difficult to underwrite, experiences more heavy losses in terms of workers' comp liability than the school segment of the market, and that's much more desired and much more sought after, whereas the property casualty market for the municipal side is much more limited.
Okay, it's just a, I knew at one time we did have choices.
Those are becoming more now.
They're becoming more now.
Yes, ma'am.
All right. Thank you.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Old business. Oh, I'm sorry.
Skipped over Jerry.
Jerry, I'm sorry.
Well, you know all about them in terms of 015, so I'll just tell you that tomorrow I'm picking up the budget book for 16-17.
And your budget rounds begin.
Yeah. So I know Nate's been working on it very hard and then sitting with our superintendent for concurrence, and he's approaching it very tight-fistedly.
Okay. Yes, yes, he does.
To piggyback on that, the CIP committee met last week. We approved the plans from both schools, and I will forward that to you hopefully tonight or tomorrow.
Okay.
Yeah, Madam Chairman?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I went to the meeting at the academy where the principal spoke and the teacher spoke, discussing all the problems in the school.
Yeah.
What I couldn't understand is how the school committee could take a vote. You haven't seen any numbers.
No, that's exactly right.
Well,
this would be a warrant article.
I understand that.
So we don't have any architectural renderings. We don't have any cost analysis at this point in time. Well, we're not passing upon that when it comes to budget.
When SAU 90 came in, they said they hired an engineering company to look at the feasibility of rehabbing or building a new school. The school committee took a vote to rehab.
Yeah.
And
several
you don't
years
have
ago.
The numbers.
Several years ago.
Huh?
Several years ago. That decision was made several years ago.
Because it seems to me that if you have to tear a building apart, well, and then you have to rebuild it, it's going to cost you more than a new building.
No, they haven't got the engineering. That's what they're doing. They don't have the answer yet.
On the front page.
I believe the survey of the facilities has been finished, and it's documented.
Budget committee, right here.
And it's going to be, I think, published soon in terms of what the conclusions are in terms of H.L. Turner, I think it is, said with respect to what they have found in each of the areas of the academy, including the wing, 73rd wing. So that's going to be for public consumption. This is how we see electrics, this is how we see plumbing, this is how we see space, this is how we see common shared areas, blah, 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 right down the line. Very specific. That'll be made public within a day or two.
Mm-hmm.
The budget books are going to be ready tomorrow afternoon. And
thank you, Jerry. Actually, before going to old business, we have IT committee.
Yes.
Didn't have on the agenda, but any subcommittee reports, but we only have one active right now. Mm-hmm. So, Tim, if you guys would, you've been very active.
Yes, we've had, since we received our first protocol, we requested protocol, as you know, from the chairman of the budget committee to interact with three entities, the town manager, the SAU 90, and the library. And we got a response from the town manager, which you all heard about because it was well covered. and we submitted a first set of questions to them immediately. And they responded fairly rapidly, that is, say, the finance director. But that engendered additional questions, which we just finalized at our last meeting. We've met approximately, or convened, 9 times since beginning of September.
Wow.
So it's... I'm kind of going to try to do a high summary of what's been done so far, but there are details if you want to know more about it. the SAU 90 protocol was vastly different than the town manager, and now we know the library protocol is mirroring the town manager's for interesting reasons, perhaps. But the SAU 90 protocol was just wide open, full transparency. basically, requests on all three of these for the protocol was to meet with the IT subcommittee chairman and discuss the protocol, or simply allow us to go and talk to whoever we deem appropriate. As you know, the town manager created a separate third choice, and that's what we're doing with that. And with SAU 90, it was like, sure, come on in. And I met with the Superintendent Kathleen Murphy, the IT Director Greg Limsky, I believe his last name is pronounced, and the Business Administrator Nathan Looney. Looney.
Yeah.
And it was an excellent meeting. We enjoyed meeting, and we got things, some things, questions that were already on the table. For example, the nature of the acquisition of the Chromebooks. As you know, they buy a lot of Chromebooks, so they don't actually buy them. They actually lease them. So we got some clarification in terms of how we're actually getting, how we're actually securing those. And then we discussed the nature of the lease contract, and I shared that with the subcommittee when we subsequently met, and we were all in agreement that proper procedures was followed and that was funded properly. Okay? But they are leases, they're not purchases. We do not own them.
Oh.
So sometimes they use the word buy, sometimes they use the word lease, so need to hear it as it's buy.
Hey guys.
So as I was saying, next step was, as I reported to the subcommittee at my next meeting, which happened to be that following evening, and shared with them the experience that I had with Superintendent Murphy and the rest of the SAU 90 staff, it was agreed that, as a kind of casual conversation I had with their IT director, that perhaps a tour would be in order of the facilities so to get a sense of how they operate from an IT perspective. And of course that dovetailed into the issue of their potential renovation at Hampton Academy. And so after interactions with them, we coordinated, actually have a subcommittee meeting in the Hampton Academy in which we discussed or had Greg tell us, in general terms, and we asked particular questions, as various subcommittees did, about various elements of what he was presenting in terms of where they are and where they see themselves potentially going. During the process of that discussion, by the way, these draft minutes for our last meeting, which actually was recessed five times because it spanned what, 10 days, but it's all incorporated in here. If you want to see it, Eileen was nice enough to print it out for me.
There's a copy for everyone, and I would suggest you take them because I actually think that, as a subcommittee, the IT committee has demonstrated a very excellent job of following protocols, having their meetings, and actually having results. So you may want to take that as even a guide for those of you who sit on other subcommittees that you could use. It has been done that well, and I thank you, Tim, and I thank you, Nick, and I thank you, Mike, for all those meetings and for setting that standard. There's a lot of information to be gathered, and while we say IT, and it's one of those little areas that we go over in like 10 seconds, but actually IT is interwoven from an expense standpoint in a lot of different areas, and just reading that and realizing how many different areas IT filters into goes to show some of the importance, and not everyone has expertise in knowing even what systems are, knowing about talking about them. I mean, I never knew about trash until I got on the recycling committee, and boy, I can tell you the best dump places around. And it's the same thing with IT and a lot of other things. They're very specialized, and when you have individuals that either one, have an interest to learn, or two, already know what they're looking at, the experience for the rest of us is very, very valuable. So please do take a copy. A lot of work went into that by these three men, and I think it should be shared by everybody.
Thank you, Madam Chair. The committee during the meeting with SAU 90 did take some policy decisions. By the way, everything the subcommittee has done, it has been done unanimously. Sometimes with contention, ultimately we all came to an agreement on whatever it was we're talking about. It was always unanimous. So I won't be redundant saying this was unanimous and that was unanimous.
Okay.
During the discussion of the need to upgrade to certain elements on the technology platform, the IT committee at that time actually said that they endorse the following position regarding SAU 90's technologies decisions in their immediate future. And that is, SAU 90 has already reached an optimal utilization of older technology. And point two was that IT industry has, beginning about 5 years ago, been undergoing fundamental changes far beyond its usual rapid evolutionary nature. The discussion then proceeded with regard to bandwidth and their growing bandwidth needs, which is getting considerable. And the subcommittee unanimously decided to adopt the following resolution, quote, that no renovation of any school building could be rightfully called a modern renovation without the complete inclusion of fiber optic lines. So that is the unanimous position of the subcommittee. The subcommittee further had discussions with Greg and his staff, and we were talking about Greg was talking about the need to integrate the various school buildings into a common network, perhaps a common hub. And we talked about the virtues and drawbacks to doing that, and the subcommittee subsequently decided to unanimously recommend that, quote, SAU 90 should prepare a request for proposal to lay fiber optics between buildings with the need for the lines to be owned and not leased, so as to avoid locking in the future to any single service provider. We were then taking on a physical tour of the building. As I mentioned earlier, that pretty much concludes our present situation, I believe, with SAU 90. Their budget is still forthcoming to us, so we'll be scrutinizing
that. See that in
comes.
December.
Yeah, the town manager, that which lives under the town manager, we asked one set of questions, and that generated a second set of questions, which I've submitted to you yesterday. So I assume that's in route to them now. Mm-hmm. We haven't naturally received a response to that yet. And of course, tonight we just got the library protocol, so I suppose that the subcommittee will be meeting rather soon to discuss next steps on coming to some of these points. So that's all I have to say. Thank you.
Thank you. We are at break time. However, I have no old business, unless you do. And under new business, all I have is the budget. Oh, Mike, yeah, you're right. Okay. You know what? In that case, let's take a real quick break.
What are you
10 flapping minutes. He wants to go.
I'm sending a message.
Oh, right. Financials.
Yeah.
It's to the chairman, not to you, Mr. Jones.
Okay, let's take a quick break. 10 minutes.
Forgive my curiosity, Mr. Pierce.
Okay, we're going to go back. Here we are. We are back. Thank you, everybody, for joining us again. We have moved down now to old business. And who do we have for issues on old business? Stephen, are we all wrapped up with you? Okay.
We're all set.
So, Mike, we're going to turn it over to you for review.
Okay. I reviewed the September expense thing that everybody got. And Christy mentioned on the front page that we are projected right now, we're under the target by 71.5K. 71.5K. So that's pretty close. That's pretty tight,
yeah,
in relation to the overall budget. If we go along at that same rate to the end of the year, we'll probably be really snug. But I have a feeling that as November and December roll along, the expenses usually go down a little bit in those 2 months, so we'll probably be okay. But you never know for sure about that. It's just a projection and an educated guess, okay, looking at that. But I do have a couple of other little things that I'd like to make some remarks about. And this is, I'll try to make this as politically correct as possible, but if you look at on page 1 of 16, general government executive and board of selectmen town manager are both over the guideline significantly, and you'd think if we were really tight on money, it would start to top and they would watch their money. But that's just a personal opinion. Make sure you understand that's not my official opinion as a budget committee member. I just tossed that out and let it roll around. And when I was looking at assessing, they've got really way over budget on their contracted services, which is on page 2 of 16, and that's pretty close to the bottom. Contracted services is about 6 or 8 lines from the bottom, and it's $60,000 over budget. So when assessing comes in, we might want to ask them what's going on with this year if we have an opportunity. And then looking...
Mike, I think we did ask them. I think we did put that question out.
I know, but I was the person who asked the question, and the question that came back, it was too generalized for my edification. And
okay. Business
is still going up. Because
right.
at the time it was 100,000, now it's 120,000. So it's chugging right along, and the budget amount is 60,000. So it makes you get your attention. And I think he might have perfectly good reasons for everything. It's just that mm-hmm. I was curious what the individual thinks.
Because the answer that you got was a good answer back on the first leg of that.
No, he just gave a general answer on that. That was a real general answer, which is fine. I went in and talked to him later, and he gave me sort of more or less the same general answer. But I think it's going to be up to the Budget Committee to pursue that a little bit when they come in. Because I think we need to find out about that for the taxpayers, exactly what's going on. Okay, and on page 5 of 16, right in the middle of the blurb there, this municipal insurance, you'll see health insurance was budgeted at 26,36,021.
What page, Mike?
Page 5 of 16. Mm-hmm. You'll see that the 15 budget was 26,36,021. And if you take the actual, which is 18,17,442, and you extend that, divide by 9, multiply by 12 stuff to come out to the year-end cost, you'll come up with 2.422 million, okay? Well, I have a problem with that because that's about $200,000 under the budget amount. And the budget amount should have been adjusted because that's contract services, and a default budget should have been to reflect the actual cost because they knew what the cost would be when they went into prepared the default budget going into this year. So there's $200,000 extra money in that default budget on that line item alone, and that should have been corrected last fall because they get the insurance rates about this time of year.
Okay.
So that's a problem there. We'll know that this budget has $200,000 worth of fat right in that one line item going forward. Okay, that was another thing that was picked up during the review. And going through the rest of it, I really didn't see anything that reached out and grabbed me other than this usual stuff, because we know that Public Works is over on snowplow. We all know that. So there's no point in talking about that. But rest of the departments, police and fire, doing a decent job of staying within the guidelines of the ending month 9, which is 75%. Public Works has got a few problems, as we expect. But I was really surprised to see that on the first two or three pages, you have general government, the town manager, and the selectmen are over budget when they wanted to get $350,000 out of the undesignated fund balance. And wow, we're setting a good example here for the rest of the town. But that was my own personal little chuckle.
Okay.
One thing just to add on to it, the new health insurance will be $2,903,524.
That's a 17% increase.
But that's
yes.
with the big increase. That's a huge increase.
Yeah, that's going to be
that
a big
was just
one.
That was brought up last night.
Yeah. Okay. Anybody else on the review?
The debt service also is down. I mean, if you look at page 14.
They said that last night.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So that's going to contribute to a very healthy variance, positive variance. Mm-hmm. So,
and the fuel cost should be a gold mine for the budget too this year if they to buy it locally.
Well, there's some areas.
I'm not getting into that. We already covered that earlier.
It has a lot to make up for what was spent in the $400,000
mm-hmm.
by the time you get to the bottom line.
Mm-hmm.
And that was for snow and ice removal. All right, we ready to move on to new business? Okay. Want to move on to the budget. Actually, you can open up the budget book to OBS1. Our budget is all of 4 lines, gentlemen.
Yep.
Doing our budget now?
Doing our budget right now.
Okay.
Here's how I see this budget year. I think when we get to the end, we're not going to be seeing very many increases in anything. And I also think that we may be looking at numbers type 2 or less than possibly the default budget. So when we do our own budget, we got to be realistic. We can put any number in there we want, but it doesn't mean that we are going to get it, and probably that we're not. biggest expense that we have is our secretary, and as you know, this year secretary got an increase because basically we couldn't find anybody at the old rate. We hadn't had an increase in 15 years I've been here, so I think it was probably long overdue. However, if we keep the same line, the only option we have is to reduce the number of meetings that we have. So your two choices. Increase the line. This year we scheduled 19 meetings. But we did go through the summer, and we did cancel the October 6th meeting. So I would say that brought us down to 18 meetings. At 15 meetings next year, you can keep the number you have. So a little bit of conversation going around the room. Tim.
I think there is a third choice. When you're speaking about cost of the minutes, you need to consider just what we're putting into the minutes. Motions, of course, are required to be put in the minutes. Discussions are not. So we don't need to reduce the number of meetings necessarily if some of the meetings that we're doing have no motions in them, just discussions about how we're going to operate, that kind of thing. Typically what we do in the springtime.
Mm-hmm.
But even still, if we're only going to have one or two motions, it's not going to be a big cost even for us to do it ourselves.
Somebody has to watch.
Even for one of us, if we're only having one motion and it's not a complex situation, for one of us to deal with that that set of minutes. So that option is a third choice, I think.
Or you ought to have one of us take the minutes.
Right, which we did from time to time.
We had that option this year,
yeah,
because we knew with the amount of money in the budget, we weren't going to be able to cover every meeting, and we did have meetings where we didn't conduct a lot of business that was voted on, and mm-hmm. we did take our own minutes.
Right. So I wanted to be sure that third choice.
You're putting that burden on whoever is sitting here next year, but that is another option.
Mm-hmm.
The question, and let me just rephrase that question. To me, the choices are at the rate we're currently paying, which isn't an hourly rate, it's a flat rate. Okay? There is enough to cover 15 minutes. Do we want to increase the budget for the coverage of the 19 that we had, actually 18 that we scheduled, okay? Or do we want to leave that amount? Because that will carry no matter what now, in the default budget, in the regular budget, and just stick to 15 paid meetings next year.
What is the flat rate?
Flat rate's 125.
Mm-hmm. I'd move to increase it to the 18.
I make a suggestion that we...
Okay, we have a motion.
You're making a motion?
Yeah.
I'm second that.
I did.
To move it to 18 meetings.
Move it to 18 meetings. Yeah. I mean, we need the meetings. We're going to have the meetings. I mean, what are we...
You're making a motion on secretary wages, right?
No.
What? I'm making a motion on...
To increase the line
to cover 18 scheduled meetings.
What is it? Where is it right now?
It would cover 15.
Okay, so it's 15.
Eileen, how did you calculate that 15? Did you use the bottom line, the budget, or the secretary wages line?
I use the secretary wages line, not the bottom line. There's more money there, okay? But I just want to do an apples for apples, okay? So we have that out there, and let's just compute that for a minute.
If you have 18 meetings at 125 a meeting, it's $2,250.
Yeah. So what you're saying is we want to increase that 1906 to 2250.
Correct.
That's the motion. Do I have a second?
Second.
Okay.
Are we ready for discussion?
Ready for discussion.
I'll start off, if you don't mind, Madam Chairman, because I had a different idea in mind to start with. The meetings we have after the election, until we actually get into like October next year, mm-hmm. which is typical every year, there's no official business really for the Budget Committee other than election of officers and tending to any policy changes we might want to do, so that the load as far as having a accurate minutes is concerned is nil. We could do that ourselves, okay? Therefore, we eliminate about three or four meetings right off the top. You have the March meeting, that we wouldn't have to have minutes taken. Then we April, And if we have one in June, we wouldn't need minutes taken for that, because if there's a motion made of any significance, we can record that easily. And so therefore, I think we should start taking minutes when we get to October, because that's when the selectmen are giving us the information.
Or September regular meeting.
That's the school comes in September.
That's right.
But no motions at that meeting.
Not very many motions at that meeting. I think October would be a place to start paying, and therefore there'd be no reason to increase the amount. You've already reduced the number from 18 to 15, no sweat.
Okay. Traditionally, too, we usually suspended meetings after the May meeting, and traditionally there was no June, July, or August meeting when we got to...
So there's your three right there.
Actually, August we suspended. So this year we ended up netting 17 meetings, not 19, I'm sorry. I forgot August we didn't do either. So that's the decision. Do you want to cover possibly 2 to 4 meetings max in the course of the year, or do you want to up what we have there for an amount?
Well, he made a motion, though, to increase the amount to cover 18
meetings.
I'm
just saying it's just an open-ended question in the mindset. Right. So we have the motion.
Can I make a comment?
Sure.
I realize that you mentioned, Tim, that you only have to record if there's motions made. Is that the only thing that's really important with the Budget Committee, though, the motions to be recorded truthfully?
Well, first of all, we have, Marie, we always have the video backup for the discussion. For the legal record, motions are important.
And people who attend, the date and time, people who attend and motions, and who voted for what, that count on the motions. That's all you'd have by statute.
What do you mean that count?
If there's 4 against and 5.
No. What do you mean when you say that's all that counts? That's all you legally have to do?
Oh, by statute, right.
Yeah. And I guess my question then is that all that has to happen is that it's legal. I mean, are there other things that are in the minutes that perhaps someone might have proposed or said that might be good to have as a record? I don't know. It's a question.
I mean, our actual minutes are expanded than other than that. But, like I say, from the standpoint that we now have a video record, that discussion is always there, is always recorded, and in many cases is better than reading the words, because sometimes it's an interpretation by whoever's writing it, and you have the actual event. I'm waiting for the day when the video records are eligible to be entered as the legal records, and then we actually would save a lot of money from a secretarial standpoint duplicating it. I've done with my discussion. Anyone else?
Yes. The only issue I have is it seems like it's a really simple thing to do, but it's not. And the secretary, I would rather see you put the other 3 days in there, because if they end up next year having a couple of extra meetings for whatever reason... I know in the past we had generally a couple of meetings where we just did some fact-finding. Maybe we didn't take any motions or anything, but at least you had that one person. It's out of our head.
Okay.
Madam Chair.
Yes.
We're talking about $375 here. I think that we talked enough about it. Can we vote?
Mm-hmm.
No, I don't think we have.
We have to talk a half hour to... go ahead.
Madam Chair, I've certainly talked enough about it. I'm going to withdraw my motion. I'm done with talking about this for one
there
more
we
second.
Go.
Okay.
We're done.
That's motion's withdrawn.
It's ridiculous.
Okay.
And if I can just, for the terms of expediency, reintroduce the gentleman's motion for 18 meetings. Can I get a second? Can we move?
Yes.
Second?
Second.
Okay. All those
discussion,
in favor?
Please.
Tim, I think we've had enough discussion on $375. All those in favor? Okay. So we have, wait a minute, because we've got a split vote here. We have Chairman Beam, we have Stephen LaBranche, we have Nick, we have Scott, we have Maureen, we have Jim, we have Sonny, we have Brian. Those opposed?
Yeah, I mean,
Okay.
15's good enough for me.
So opposed, Mike, Jerry, Tim, and Eileen. And that's for our secretary. And no abstentions. Okay.
Shocked, Mr. B.
All right, so we will move that line to 22.
Get a motion with no dollar amount. I'm shocked.
I assume that motion includes the 22.
Well, assumptions now. Assumptions, yeah. Mm.
You said 18 meetings.
18 meetings would be 22.
Yeah.
50.
I'll make a motion we delete the $300 in staff development.
I will second that if you amend the motion to allow people who speak on it
no,
who wish to.
Let me.
Could you amend that accordingly?
Okay. There's a motion to reduce the 300 to zero.
Mm-hmm.
Do I have a second?
He's second it.
Who's second it?
Him.
All right.
What?
You second it. He met the conditions.
Oh, he did amend it?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, great.
All right.
I did.
We're moving along here. Come on.
Okay.
Yeah, I don't want to be here all night. I'm four lines, okay? This is how the budget is
okay.
going to go. And this is your own
discussion.
And this is your own budget that you're sending forward to those who
I
come
know.
After you.
Fine.
All right.
Ready
first
vote.
Of all, the staff development is your education that we send you to seminar, $75 a person. This year we did not do that. We got municipal to come to us.
Mm.
You cannot take for granted that you will be given that every year because other departments may have a need for that. As this committee will be reduced in the future, I don't see a problem with reducing it to 150. However, I would caution you that I would not reduce it to zero because you do want to educate new people coming in. You do want them. Years ago, we didn't pay for the seminar. Now the seminar is $75 a person, probably will go up. And with only, let's put it this way, with fewer members in the future, they will not be as enthusiastic about coming here to do a seminar for us. Okay? And I'm talking about municipal. And do it. They did that free because we pay over $15,000 a year in municipal dues, and we are entitled to one free seminar that they come and bring to us. That may better be served in the future as a 91A seminar. I'm not suggesting what it should be. I'm just suggesting we lucked out this year based on our budget, and we may not be that lucky again. So, that motion, any other discussion on the motion to reduce that line to zero? Tim.
I think it's important that the Budget Committee not just run through the process like others might wish to do. It doesn't demonstrate the very thing we expect departments to do, to actually scrutinize what we're doing. On that general statement, I want to make a point on staff development. Eileen makes an excellent point that last year, after some posturing or positioning, however you want to phrase it, we managed to get an HMA in here and give us a seminar for all of us, which was great. It would be great if we could have that again next year. Not the same seminar necessarily, but something a little bit more refined.
Mm.
But that, of course, requires the Board of Selectmen to cooperate on that. Doesn't cost the town anything, not one penny to do that. So I think what we need to do is really kind of query the Board of Selectmen on that point before we move on that particular item.
No,
and anyway,
I'm going to disagree with you, and I'm going to
disagree with you on your time.
Yeah. All right, I will, but let's get done.
Fine. So I think we ought to leave that line item there as it is. We can change it later on under final review. All right. Also, I think that under staff development, there may be some materials. For example, as a result of a request by the chairman, I managed to find myself having to study yet another RSA, namely RSA 21-J, in which I discovered that the DRA actually is ordered by law, required by law, to print up a document to aid us in our work at a nominal fee, not specified in law. So we certainly don't want to go to zero because we might have to pay $1 to get these handbooks that they produce every year at state expense. Okay, so I'm absolutely against reducing it to zero, and pending getting information from the Board of Selectmen in terms of them allowing us to have an HMA and come in again next year, I would suggest that we just leave it as it is right now, we review it at final review. It's a small item to deal with, but why deal with it now? Enough said. Thank you.
Sonny?
Actually, we've got three new members that haven't had the training. They'll be on it.
Yeah, we had the training.
So you might as well leave the budget the way it is, that line item.
Should we vote?
Okay, so we had a motion?
I made a motion.
To eliminate it?
I just don't think it's significant. $300 you're talking about or whatever, it's not going to have a significant impact in this room. I think we haven't spent anything to date. And
but we always have, Jerry.
We've chopped it from 12 people to 6.
Yeah.
So you're going to have a lot of the same people here next year.
We don't know what the number is next year.
So, I mean, it's to me, I see it as an insignificant line item.
Okay. I'm going to move this to a vote. All those in favor of reducing it to 0? 1. Okay. Jerry? Opposed? Abstentions? Okay. So the vote is what? Yeah. 12. All right, and the last, well, we haven't decided now what that line should be. Do I have a motion?
It's just going to stay, we're not going to do motions by, right, line by line.
No, I'm going to do motions line by line on this budget.
Subline by subline.
All right, so I move
legal expenses for $1.
I'm going back to the 300. I want a motion.
Oh, you jumped ahead.
Staff development.
Staff development.
I move staff development remain as it was last year, $300, pending further wisdom from various sources as earlier specified.
Second.
Wait a minute. Pending wisdom from who?
Other sources earlier specified. Namely, the Board of Selectmen's regard to NHMA, as well as getting information.
No, I don't want any of that in there. I want a clean motion. It has nothing, absolutely nothing to do with the Board of Selectmen and nothing to do with NHMA.
It's my motion. I second it.
No.
Anybody want to pitch in $300? Let's get this done right now.
I'm waiting for your money, Steve.
All right, I'm going to make an amendment to that motion. I'm going to amend that motion to $300 be left in that flat period, no other wording. I have a second for the amendment.
I'll second it.
Thank you. I have a vote.
On the amendment?
On the amendment. All those in favor?
What's the amendment?
$300. I'll keep it at $300.
To leave the $300 alone, no other wording. Okay. All right. Opposed?
No.
All right.
No, that should be obliterated.
Jerry's opposed. Tim, you opposed?
No, I abstained.
You abstained.
I abstained.
And you abstained. So Michael and Tim abstained to leaving it at the 300 with no other additional wording. And so that amendment passes. So
now we can vote on the motion.
No,
mm-hmm.
Okay.
You want to ask for a vote?
We
don't
have to vote.
And now can I have a vote on... You know, this is where you guys take a left turn.
Yeah,
okay?
We're following procedure. That's true.
Huh?
Call for a vote.
At this point?
Yeah.
I'm calling to home.
Please.
All right. Calling for a vote on the motion to accept the 300. Mm. All those in favor? Yeah, we're going to accept the 300. We accepted the amendment.
Right.
Now we have to accept the 300. All right. And opposed? Jerry, abstentions? Selectman Bean, you voted?
I voted in favor, ma'am.
I'm sorry, I just didn't see you. Calling that out for our secretary.
Tim, did you abstain?
No, I voted in favor. She's got to be right.
Okay. Now, moving on to supplies and expenses.
I'll make a motion that we leave that at 350.
Second? Anybody with a second?
Second.
Okay. Same thing. We don't need a discussion on this one. All those in favor?
There we go.
I didn't hear the motion.
Opposed? Abstain. Yeah. Abstain. All right. Now,
I cannot vote for a motion that doesn't allow for discussion. There's one other line item you skipped over, Madam Chair, that's legal expenses, so I move $1 for legal expenses.
I'll second that.
All right, I'm going to open up the discussion with that one myself.
Some we discuss, some we don't.
You finally get one we like.
All right, I'm going to start it out by giving you a history, which also speaks to why I wanted the wording retracted from your motion on the previous issue. We went through years of not having legal advice, and this has nothing to do with the current board. I will say that up front. We went through years, we had nothing for a legal line. And we got into a couple of years where we really did need legal advice. We had almost nothing available to us from a legal standpoint. Town council, you have to remember, represents the board.
Yeah.
If we have a disagreement with the board, we have no representation because it's a conflict of interest for Attorney Gerald. The only time he can advise us is if it's not a conflict with the Board of Selectmen. That being said, we built in, as well as the planning board built in, $2,000 for legal services. That way we would never have our back against the wall, because none of us, I don't think anybody here is an attorney. We do the best we can. With the RSAs, a lot of this gets very complicated, and sometimes you need a better mind than your own when it comes to getting advice. We got that passed, and for a couple of years we rode with that money in the budget. And I'll tell you, going backwards a little bit in the history, Mary Louise got into a position with this very committee where we had no legal advice, we needed legal advice, and her and I looked at each other and said, okay, we'll take it out of our pockets and pay for it. And very last minute, the issue was resolved, and it was resolved to our argument. We didn't take anything out of our pockets, but went that far. So thus we entered into putting $2,000 in the budget, so no committee after us would ever be in that situation again, for the good of the public. 3 years ago, in an effort to trim the budget, because don't forget, we had it, planning board built it in, the two of us. We gave the town a savings of $4,000 in the budget in an agreement with Attorney Gerald that if we needed representation, we would go to him, and it would come out of the outside council funds. Now, when we got to this year, that came off the table. And it was just not approaching Attorney Gerald. There is a protocol in place, but it would call for the Board of Selectmen to approve all the issues that we want addressed in regard to legal funds. So that's where you are. Your dispute to begin with would be with the board, and if you wanted then to access legal funds so that basically you could contest a decision or contest something going on, you then have to go to the person that you're contesting to get permission to use legal funds, which seems a little awkward, to say the least.
Awkward.
So here we are again. Do we go back to putting money in our budget? And I will tell you, I mean, this is something that I take as part of my job in going out there and trying to find legal opinions and you know, searching the landscape out there, from everything from municipal to people that we know to whatever there is out there, to get a legal decision without it costing us any money. But I'll tell you, it takes hours and hours and hours, and not everybody's willing to do that. We're running into that right now. If we had an attorney, we would have had an answer to Warren Article 48 the week after the election. Instead, we're 5-6 months into this, and we're still, it's gone to the Secretary of State, it's gone to the AG. I mean, sometimes you got to do that, just have somebody write the letter legally, just to cut through it. But here we are again at the 2000. On top of that, Tim has done a lot of research into the Warren articles on where and how we can be covered. So again, we have options as to what we can do for a move. But I want them all laid out on the table, because even though in the realm of $26 million, $2,000 is not a lot of money, when we get stuck, it really is. So this might be a little bit of education to base our decision on. So if, Tim, you want to enlighten us with what you found in the statutes.
Regarding what particular topic?
Legal.
Yeah, Madam Chair. Well, I mean, RSA 32, the budget law, affords us certain legal options, which are not worthy of going into in this topic, in my opinion. And I think you covered pretty well the history as well as the conflict. I mean, if you're going to sue your next-door neighbor and you have to ask your next-door neighbor if he will pay for your attorney before you begin your suit, it seems rather silly. Mm-hmm. But that's effectively what Eileen described. And so, you know, that is kind of sort of where we're at. From my own personal point of view, I made a motion because I'm tired of seeing that to be zero, implying we're not allowed to move any money into it. So I just said, well, let's throw a dollar in there and get rid of that implication. I'm not thinking it was going to be a big deal, frankly. I don't really have anything more to say because that's essentially my thoughts on that particular subline.
Can I say something?
Mm-hmm, Steve.
If it's zero, then you can't do anything.
It's a subline.
Okay.
That's only true on line items, not subline items.
Oh, okay.
Subline, so okay. We can change it.
Okay.
10 hours of lawyer's time is about $1,000.
So the dollar doesn't buy us anything?
No.
Dollar doesn't buy anything.
No, I'm just saying.
It doesn't protect any rights. So
I'm just getting rid of the implication that some people have when they see a zero there. So it's not.
Now, does the LGC provide any support to the budget committee?
Madam Chair. No.
Let me answer
you
this
mean
one
NHMA?
First.
No, the local government center.
Yeah.
No.
That which is NHMA.
NHMA does offer some assistance. Yes.
They offer guidance, Jerry, which is we're up to our eyeballs in guidance, but not legal decisions. So there may be instances when you need an attorney to force the absolute legal decision.
And if we were getting into a disagreement with the Board of Selectmen, their first obligation is the board.
Right.
Because they pay the fees.
They pay the fees.
14 or 15,000 or something.
They have representatives at HMA and we do not.
And they remind you of that when you call.
Right.
Yes.
Well, if we're going to face that, then we ought to put an amount of money in that line item that makes sense. And it's $200, $250 an hour per lawyer. And 10 hours could be gobbled up like that. So,
what was it before?
I'm happy. I might as well speak at the same time, right?
I'm sorry?
Go ahead. In the legal department, you have $50,000 line for outside counsel. The town council, every department goes to the town council first. If you disagree, you ask the town council for a ruling. If you disagree with his ruling, you go to an outside council.
Only with the Board of Selectmen's blessing.
Only with their approval.
Only with their approval.
The planning board went to disagree with Mark Giraldo on one item,
well,
they went to an outside council.
That
the Board of Selectmen approved that going outside council.
One of the very first requests that I made when the town passed Warren Article 48, I requested that town council, and it was a request, contact the attorney general, send them a letter as to the legality of that particular Warren article and how it would be, how the attrition would work. And the response that I got back was that...
Was no.
Madam
Chair, if I may. My motion was a symbolic one.
Would you like to change it?
And it appears as though others have a more substantial thought to have. So I will retract my motion to allow others to make something more than a symbolic motion.
Okay, thank
motion.
You.
I'll do make a motion to add $2,000.
Okay, do I have a second to that motion?
I'll second.
Okay. Any further discussion? All right.
In my opinion... we've already, independent of the motion, we've already increased the budget committee's budget by 15%.
It is what it is.
And that's what I'm telling. That's what I'm saying. What it is. At this particular moment, it doesn't look that good in terms of us being really good about budgets. However, I do think that the argument for the 18 meetings with the secretary has real merit to it.
My resistance to it was largely to do with I don't want to see the Budget Committee increasing their budget. This particular line item is another one that also has real merit. I have the same problem with it I had with the 18 thing times 125. But I would say that there is, I think Sunny said $50,000 for outside counsel. So later on, when we get around to it, maybe final review, we take whatever it is we're increasing the Budget Committee budget by, we take it perhaps out of another line item like outside counsel, because it's effectively the same thing.
There you go.
Okay.
We dropped their budget by $300,000.
So if there's an inclination to do that, then I can support this motion.
Sounds good to me.
Okay, thank you.
There's another thing you can put on the table. The lawyers over the Municipal Association will give you legal advice.
They'll give you guidance, but not advice.
We talked about that. They'll give us guidance, but not an end result.
I understand what you're...
All right. Let's put this to a vote. All those in favor of increasing that line to $2,000? Okay, so we have Jerry,
yep.
Tim, Eileen, Mike, Maureen. All those opposed.
Looks like it's an opposition.
We have Nick, Scott, Jim, Sonny, Brian.
Why hasn't nobody argued against it? Somebody voted against it.
Because we're tired of talking.
Put it in, we take it out, we put it in, we take it out, year after year.
All right. So what you're suggesting, now we should readdress this at final review. Okay.
You got to call a vote?
All right. It fails.
Yep.
Yes.
Okay.
All right.
So now I have for a total line item for the Budget Committee of 2,900, is that right?
Thirty-five, forty minutes discussing a $2,500 budget. And people don't think we're going to need 15 meetings next year when we're going to be looking at budgets that are a little bit more than $2,500. And we spent all that time talking about putting money back into a budget to chase boogeymen.
Really?
I mean, we talked earlier about, well, we need this money maybe because someone wouldn't let us get information based on last year's warrant article that passed. But at the beginning of the meeting, Mr. Chairman, you told us that the Attorney General told you that the decision is imminent and they're going to send you some information.
I didn't say
that.
I said he would be getting back to me. And this is 6 months later. We've been asking this question.
But nothing has happened in 6 months.
I would tell you this.
So what happened in 6 months? There's no one has been removed from the board. The board hasn't changed. So it really doesn't matter if it's another 2 months. Nothing is going
to
happen.
Well, maybe to you it doesn't matter. And if we have major decisions, one of the decisions I talked about, Jerry, you remember, it had to do with funds under $50,000 in funds that we interceded with and had a 2-week stretch to take care of. And if we had not interceded in $150,000 in funds, they would have been spent the wrong way and would have had far-reaching ramifications. Mike, do you remember?
That these are all history lessons that I don't
think they're history lessons, but you learned not to repeat.
There was a motion made. There was a motion defeated. I say we move on.
Well, actually, I'm making an issue out of it because, quite honestly, there are a lot of people on this committee who do a lot of work. And this one little question about Warrant Article 48, I have tens of hours in on this one, and I'm the one out there looking for the legal help, looking for the legal opinions.
And that's great, Madam
Chair. How much time have you spent on it?
The voters spoke.
They spoke.
The voters spoke loud and clear. I'm not spending any time on it.
Well, they're so loud and clear
that
and
if you want them to change their mind, put another warrant article on and say, I think you made a mistake. Now I'd like you to do this.
I don't want them to change their mind. I just want to be clear on what they said.
You want to be clear on what they said.
Aren't we getting to that point?
I hope so.
Without a dollar.
We're not there yet.
Without a dollar being spent, the Attorney General is going to tell us exactly.
Jim, I'll only point out to you that your sensitivity on time ought to be right now. We've got no motion on the table to have any discussion on. So let's move on to the next point.
That's up to the chair. That's up to the chair. That's not up to me or you. That's up to the chair.
I understand that, but it wasn't up to
you. Are you making a motion to move on?
Yeah, I'm making a motion to move on.
Okay.
I'll second that.
There you go.
We having a vote on that?
Why do we need to have a motion for that, Jim?
Right. Yeah, I'm going to make a motion to adjourn.
Do I have a second?
Oh, yes. One more item of new business. We do have a vacancy, do we not?
No.
Yes, we do.
Yes, we will.
Before we adjourn, I've got something I'd like to say.
Excuse me, we have it passed.
Wait a minute. 1 minute, everybody. Nick has got the floor right now with the subject, and Nick, you're right. We do have a vacancy. It's a very delicate situation. I don't think we've ever been in a position where we've lost a member for death, so hard to bring it up. But we do have a position on this committee. Glenn had been elected for a 3-year term, and this was the first of that 3-year term. So we do need someone to fill his seat for the remainder of this year. That person would not be filling a 3-year term. That seat would be up for election for 2 years in March. But for now, anyone interested in us considering them for this vacancy can contact me or contact the town manager. Thank you for mentioning that.
Thank you.
Okay, we have a motion on the floor.
No, wait a minute. Sonny has a...
I've got a different area I wanted to raise. I was looking at the library's proposed budget. You know, every library in the area, practically every library in the state does gross budgeting. The Hampton Library doesn't do gross budgeting. They have an unappropriated account. They have about $120,000 in trust funds. It doesn't show up anywhere.
Do you want questions specifically? Okay.
I've already asked you to forward it.
Right.
You know, otherwise I'll move to table their budget and explain why when they show up.
Thank you. Stephen.
I made a motion to adjourn.
Second? Okay.
We don't need discussion on
that. All those in favor to adjourn, 9:28. Thank you, gentlemen.